We are looking at the Boss OC-2 Octaver. It is almost always the answer to the question, if you could only take one pedal out of the house to a gig, what would it be? I talk with my good friend and low-end manipulator, John Davis, about this all the time. We both agree that if our pedals got lost, we could literally just locate an OC-2 and be able to get through an entire gig with Jojo Mayer's band Nerve playing electronic music with just this pedal. Now, let's start the show. So the OC-2 has been in my board for close to 20 years. These settings were shown to me as they were to Tim Lefebvre, to John Davis, by Jojo Mayer. We all share one gig in common that we've all played in Jojo's band, Nerve. So this is, to me, the most useful, most musical, and quite electronic way to use the OC-2. In fact, in this entire video, I'm not gonna use any of the clean sound. I really think the second octave is a little bit redundant on this pedal, and it's all about cranking octave one and taking the clean signal completely out of the pedal to get that super electronic sine wavy sound. A lot of people talk about the difference between the Taiwanese made and the Japanese made OC-2s. I think there is a little difference to my ear. I think the tracking might be slightly better in the older Japanese made OC-2s, but at the end of the day, I'm not using this pedal to be an accurate octave pedal. I don't want a true representation of my bass sound, an octave down, that tracks exactly with my playing. I'm specifically using this pedal for it to be glitchy, for it to sound a little bit more like a machine, and for it to sound synthetic. And more than anything else, I'm actually trying to mask the natural sound of the bass. Today is all about the OC-2, and in particular, how I like to combine it with other pedals. Like I said in the intro, the OC-2 really is that one pedal I could get through an entire electronic music gig with. But with the luxury of combinations, I really like to combine it with some sort of low pass filter. For today, I'm using the Iron Ether Zero Graph Deluxe. I did, much like Tim Lefebvre, much like John Davis, used to use the Moogafuga low pass filter. That thing is just huge, and I think the Iron Ether Zero Graph sounds amazing, as you are about to hear. And I've lately really been digging the Aguilar Fuzzista for my fuzz. This really goes a long way to adding that synth sound when it's combined with the low pass filter, with the expression pedal and the OC-2. Speaking of expression pedals, I'm using my Jim Dunlop Mini with a TRS cable. And to top it off for today's signal chain, I've brought out the old Boss PN2 stereo tremolo pan pedal. Now, like all good pedals, like the OC-2 that is no longer made, the PN2 is no longer made. And if Boss were ever thinking about making some Wazza Craft pedals, I would nominate the OC-2 and the PN2 to be first in line for a Wazza version. So let's get stuck into the sound examples. A quick note about my signal chain today. I'm using my Aguilar Tonehammer 500. I'm using my Noble Tube preamp and DI, which is going into my interface. I am monitoring in the room with an Aguilar SL212, and I have a tiny bit of soft compression up front in my signal chain with the Miura M2 compressor limiter. And also, let's not forget that in the last episode, I was looking at the Iron Ether Dub Terrania. That has an amazing OC-2 clone circuit in it that could end up replacing the OC-2 on the board if I was in a pinch for real estate. And also, we couldn't do an OC-2 episode without talking about Tim Lefebvre's Octaver. This is the original, the large chassis. I know they've miniaturized it now and made it about half this size. This is by Three Leaf Audio, and it does an amazing job of cloning the OC-2. Plus, it's a super robust pedal. It's not something that's gonna die on you. And if your OC-2s, especially the Japanese ones, the expensive ones, are precious to you, you don't wanna be beating them up on the road so much. the Tim Lefebvre Octaver is a really, really great solution in terms of touring and being robust on the road. Now to start out, I just want to give you some basic sound samples of the OC-2, followed immediately by the three-leaf audio Octaver. All the settings for all of these sounds will be on screen as the audio samples are happening. Get a lot of questions about, okay, Japanese, Taiwanese, black label, yet your silver screw, all of these terms that I'm sure you've heard. Most importantly, one of the biggest ways to tell the difference between a Japanese one and a Taiwanese one is that very early on, they started making these in April of 1982. It was called Octaver. It had an R on the end. And I believe in about 1984, they took the R out, still made in Japan, called Octave. And with the black label on the back saying made in Japan. So that's a really kind of obvious visual cue as to how you can tell. You can also open the pedal up, take a look inside, and if it was made in Japan, it will have a sticker with a serial number on it, which will say, you know, product of Roland Japan, and you can actually date your pedals to the exact month they were made. I'll leave a link to the website that facilitates that in the description below the video. I believe the two earliest ones I have, the two that still have the R on the end, from 1982. One is from October and one is from November. So very early on in the run of making them. But as you can see, kind of trashed in the back. They don't have the original stickers. They've been Velcroed. That's the classic thing. As soon as you put Velcro on one of these, the first time you take the Velcro off, the sticker completely disappears. Another fairly common telltale sign as to where the pedal was made is the location of the power jack on the back of the pedal. You'll see that on the old Japanese OC-2, the Octaver, it's down low. And then here is the general rule of thumb that on a Taiwanese made pedal, they are generally up a little higher, located off the bottom of the pedal. Now there are some exceptions to that rule. I do have a made in Taiwan black label, but with the power input in the lower side towards the bottom of the pedal. So that's not a completely foolproof method of telling exactly where and when your pedal was made. And one final indicator, if you want to get super nerdy, is to open the pedal up, to take it apart, to take out the little plastic protector and to peel back the circuit board and see which chip you have located on the back of the circuit board, the older ones being the BA 6-3-4, and the newer ones being some version of 4-0-1-3, I believe. And that also doesn't tell you exactly when or where your pedal was made, because I do have some earlier Taiwanese ones that still have that chip in them. Of course, the oldest Japanese ones I have that chip in them. And then I do have a couple of pedals from the late 90s, even from about 2002, shortly before they stopped making them in September of 2003. I have some of those later ones that do have the 4013 chip in them. Now, I have lots of other octave pedals. That is for another video at another time, a shootout between the weird, the wonderful, the old, the unheard of, and just about everything in between. We will get to that at a later date. And before you leave me tons of comments saying, oh, what about this OC-2 clone and that OC-2 clone, and how about doing a shootout? Listen, I'm aware that there are other pedals that do clone the OC-2. For instance, the Bass Octave Deluxe, the little brother of this, the little cousin, the vintage Bass Octave, or whatever it's called by MXR, I know it clones the OC-2. You know why I know? Because they actually used this exact pedal. They took my OC-2, original OC-2, from October of 1982, MXR took this and cloned it to make that pedal. Haven't tried the pedal. Apparently sending me one in return for lending them mine was not part of the deal. But the OC-2 is something that's very special to me. It's something that's been in my board for almost 20 years. That's why I wanted to make a video about it early on, and why I want to now present you with some sounds, basically the whole signal chain that we talked about earlier on in the video, but with drums. I've got some drums from the Loop Loft. Mark Juliana is the drummer on this one, and I basically run through the signal chain in the same order that we did before, this time without the three leaf. It's just the OC-2s, so you can really hear what all of those sounds sound like in context with a groove and with a drummer and with kind of a more real life situation. As always, please do not underestimate the value of subscribing to the channel, of following on social media, giving us a thumbs up, or sharing this video with a friend. That really helps the channel to grow. It helps me to make more free content like this in the future. So we'll play out of this video with these musical examples, me playing with some drums, running through that entire signal chain, start to finish, and I'll see you all on the next video. Yeah.